Dover, Britain's largest port and gateway to Europe. But if I'd been standing here 3,500 years ago, I would have witnessed a revolution. And we know that because it was here that one of the world's oldest seagoing boats has been discovered. Unlocking the secrets of this famous Bronze Age boat reveals a sophisticated prehistoric society.
Is it going to fit?
We'll join a team of experts on an ambitious mission to master ancient skills.
One, two, three, go!
As they build a replica of the Dover boat.
I think this is going to be a nightmare.
It's a complex craft, an astonishing window into the past. Groundbreaking archaeology is unearthing how boats connected the nation.
It's spectacular, isn't it?
It's enormous, yeah.
And revealing a cosmopolitan people who looked beyond Britain for the first time in the quest for riches. At a time when the wheel was only just invented, Britain was transformed from an island nation into a cross-channel trading superpower.
A time when Britain shook off the ancient and joined the modern world.
Life 3,500 years ago is something of a mystery. It was the Bronze Age, the dawn of the age of metal, but little evidence survives. 20 years ago, though, archaeologists in Dover town centre unearthed something that would transform our picture of this time. 6 metres underground was the most intact Bronze Age boat ever found. It had been abandoned in an ancient creek, its oak timbers perfectly preserved in the mud. At 56 feet long and 3,500 years old, it was an astonishingly rare find. Pete Clark worked on the excavation.
When we found the boat, we had no idea what we were looking at. It was absolutely fantastic excavating it. I remember distinctly when we were taking away the mud from the timbers, they were a pale golden colour and they went black in front of your eyes. It was absolutely incredible.
If you're at all interested in history or archaeology or even in do-it-yourself, then this boat will completely blow you away. It's a prehistoric masterpiece. It almost looks like a sculpture, doesn't it? And for me, the most intriguing thing about it is that it's sewn together without using one single nail. The shape, size, and location of this boat raised a tantalizing possibility. This was no primitive prehistoric boat. Here was a craft that could go to sea. But nobody's decoded the secrets of how Bronze Age man actually built it.
The boat was incomplete. We didn't manage to get one end of the boat. Some of the timbers had been removed in antiquity, and the whole boat had been compressed, squashed by its long burial under the earth. So we don't know what the original shape of the boat was. We don't know how the complex jointing actually worked, and we don't know what the end of the boat was like. So the only thing we can do to answer these questions is do some experimental archaeology, is to build a boat and put it into the water and see if it floats.
So in Dover Museum's garden, experts are doing just that and attempting a replica. Ancient timber specialist Richard Darrah and Robin Wood face a Herculean task. First, they have to transform these 7-metre oak trees into workable planks.
How long will it take you to get that trunk from how it is now into a plank that you can put into the boat?
It's a couple of weeks' work to change a piece like this into a plank.
Because these bronze tools take things away chip by chip by chip. It's an awful lot of wood chips.
So basically, you're saying this is going to be really easy?
It's a bit like riding a bicycle. When you can do it, it feels easy, but it'll take quite a long time.
The team are building a half-scale vessel and are in uncharted waters. Even their tools have been reconstructed from scratch, based on marks found on the original boat. They're dealing with the technology lost for over 3,000 years. What's more, to get funding for the replica,
they've promised to finish it in time for an exhibition in just 4 months. The Dover boat was a new chapter in boat building, the product of thousands of years of evolution.
The first boats we think people built were skin-covered boats. So you have a framework made of wood, but you cover it with animal skin. That gives you a nice boat that's very light and can easily be transported. Then around 9,000 years ago, people start to build the very first log boat. So they hollow out a tree log, make it watertight front and back, and start to use those type of craft. And then the third type of boat is the plank boat. And the oldest plank boats being built in England is from around 2000 BC. And the Dover boat is one of those so-called sewn plank boats. So you have planks that are sewn together.
The Dover boat was a unique prehistoric jigsaw. Over 17 metres long and 2.5 metres wide, it was made from 10 oak planks and weighed 5 tonnes. It was held together using wedges hammered through cleats. The side planks were sewn together with ropes made from yew branches, and the whole thing waterproofed with moss and beeswax. The boat dates to about the same time as Tutankhamun, 1600 BC, the middle of Britain's Bronze Age. Francis Pryor is Britain's leading expert on this time.
The Bronze Age represents the period when the British landscape became tamed and civilized, when you had settlements and roads and fields and farms. If you'd gone back to the Bronze Age today, you'd feel quite at home, I think.
We'd come a long way from the Stone Age, a much more primitive time in history. The Bronze Age began around 2200 BC, and life by then was quite different. Families lived in roundhouses within tribal communities of industrious farmers and skilled craftsmen. It lasted about 1500 years until the discovery of iron.
What do we mean by the Bronze Age? What was it?
It's all about technology. Before that, you had something like 2 million years of stone technology, the Stone Age. And then they invent this magnificent stuff, bronze, which is a mixture of copper and tin. And the introduction of axes in particular, made out of bronze, it had a transforming effect. It was the equivalent, the prehistoric equivalent, of the introduction of steam engines.
At a time when the wheel was only just beginning to appear in Britain, and boats the only reliable means of transport, the invention of bronze sparked the birth of modern carpentry. Many joints we use today were first invented in the Bronze Age. Back at the reconstruction, it's all hands on deck. The boat is a collection of handcrafted individual pieces. They need to learn how Bronze Age man joined them together without nails, which means mastering complex ancient woodworking.
It's a very strange piece of wood. This isn't a plank, is it?
I guess it is a plank. It's just a curved plank, or it's going to be at the end of the day. This here is going to be the cleat, which is a little upstanding piece that helps join the planks together at the end of the day.
If it's going to strap the planks together, does that mean you'll put a hole through it?
It will. It'll have a little hole to lash the thing together.
But it does mean that this cleat isn't fixed on to the plank below it, it's part of the plank below.
It's part of the plank, and that gives it strength.
The boat had 28 cleats. Wedges were tapped in at different angles to join the planks together. This ingenious design enabled the building of a supersized boat.
The bigger the boat is, the safer it is at sea. So, and I think that the purpose of building these very large boats in the Bronze Age is to have a seafaring type craft.
At 56 feet long, the Dover boat was certainly big enough to handle the sea, but is there any evidence that it did so?
We've got a few clues. Down at that end of the boat, we found a very small piece of shale from Kimmeridge in Dorset. Now, shale at that time was used for making buttons and jewellery, so maybe this boat had gone all the way down to the southwest of Britain to bring back the raw materials for jewellery. But the clincher, we know it went to sea, is that On the bottom of the boat was a very thin layer of sand. We had that sand analysed, and it's a kind of sand that does not appear in Dover at all. So the boat had to go somewhere else. And from Dover, with the White Cliffs, if you're going somewhere else, you're at sea immediately.
But there's a big difference between hugging the coast and hitting open water. The reconstruction team want to work out if the Dover boat was capable of crossing the channel. But first of all, they need to assemble the pieces of their prehistoric jigsaw to see if they fit together.
Oh, yeah, it's really looking like a boat now, all of a sudden, isn't it? Richard, it doesn't fit. There's a big gap there and a big gap down your end, Robin.
Yes, but that's all right, because what we're going to do is we're going to bend them and then they'll join onto the bottom plank. And we also bend the bottom planks up as well.
But to do that, they'll have to master a technique used 3,500 years ago. And there's no room for error. If they can't do it, there's no boat. In Dover, a team of experts are on a mission to match the skills of their Bronze Age predecessors by rebuilding a 3,500-year-old boat capable of crossing the channel. The original boat was streamlined so it could ride waves. In other words, a boat with a curved bottom and sides. But they didn't create the curve with an axe. There's evidence that they used a surprising technology, steam power. When timbers are heated to 70 degrees, they become flexible enough to bend.
They would have to heat large amounts of stones in a fire, and when they've heated them in the fire, they would then take the stones and drop them into some water, which would surround the boat, so they got steam.
The team are bending one of the bottom planks using a bit of a Heath Robinson-type contraption, a polystyrene box heated with wallpaper steamers. And on hand with some extra hot air, Phil Harding and Francis Pryor.
What do you mean? This is only half size.
So, Phil, we've got a job for you.
Once out of the steamer, the fibres in the wood only flex for 3 minutes before going rigid. Putting a heavy weight on the plank during the 3 minutes helps it bend and then hold its shape when it cools, giving you a streamlined, curved hull.
Why me to hold it down?
Well, I'm not... I'm not eating enough pies.
Have you got a job for someone with brains?
Yeah, but hang on. Francis, are you carrying your brains in your waistband?
They might be laughing, but getting this right is no mean feat, even at half scale. In the Bronze Age, a skilled team would have sweated blood to steam and bend planks twice this size.
Are we all ready? Good. 3, 2, 1, go! OK, guys, across. OK. Right. And lying down.
And oh, go in there.
Go. Nice.
Somehow or another, the plank is gone right the way down.
Maybe have Francis stood on the top of this one.
Yep.
Something was driving the need for such a big, complicated boat. It was built in the middle of the Bronze Age, a time of rapid change. Central to that change was metal itself. 600 years before the Dover boat was built, when bronze was first invented, it was bound up in ritual and religion.
There's no doubt that this was, in some respects, regarded as slightly magical. And the bronze smiths and the people who made these implements almost certainly were seen to have sort of special powers. Bronze was treated in a way that's rather like people. I mean, sometimes these objects were actually, in effect, given burial by being placed in water.
But by the Middle Bronze Age, there was a boom in the demand for bronze. To make bronze, you needed copper and tin, which was rare. But in Devon and Cornwall, Britain had huge deposits of tin. And like all other goods, it was shifted around the country via a network of rivers. On a dig in Cambridgeshire, archaeologists recently found evidence of how central trade was to ordinary life. They unearthed an unbelievable haul, 8 perfectly preserved riverboats. Is this unique in Britain? When was the last time people found this number of boats?
It's unique in Europe. It really is fabulous. Well, I think what we've got here is a typical Bronze Age river scene. It's just that we've never found one before because people have never looked in the right places.
On the site of a modern brickworks, deep quarrying revealed a prehistoric water world. Along an ancient river channel was evidence of a lively, bustling community. Fish traps, weirs, beautiful pottery, and 8 dugouts, canoe-like boats made from hollowed-out tree trunks.
This is one of the largest ones that we've found.
It's spectacular, isn't it?
It's enormous, yeah. It's amazing. So you can see, I mean, you're getting towards the limits of how big a tree can grow. So, yeah. You know, essentially how big you can build your boat. And you can see how thick it is. You know, how thick it is here, you know, it's very sturdy.
I love this end here.
Yeah, it's lovely. So we've got like a raised lip, as it were, up here. So you almost imagine someone sort of sitting up there, didn't want to get themselves wet or in the rest of the boat.
Boats like these were the workhorses of the Bronze Age, rivers, the ancient highways connecting Britain. But there's new evidence that in the very early Bronze Age, 4,000 years ago, people were looking to coastal waters to move goods around. The discovery of another ancient boat proves that these vessels were markedly different. Here in Falmouth, Cornwall, a local team have constructed a boat based on a vessel that's 500 years older than the Dover boat. In the 1960s, at Ferriby, on the banks of the Humber River in Yorkshire, archaeologist Ted Wright found the remains of a 4,000-year-old sewn plank boat. 2/3 were missing, and it was less sophisticated than the Dover boat. Here was an earlier precursor. Archaeologist Robert van der Noort and shipwright Brian Cumby worked on its reconstruction.
Why did you do this reconstruction?
Well, we only ever found 1/3 of the whole boat. And just so that means that there are lots of questions unanswered. And one of the fundamental questions we want to ask, well, are these river-going boats or are these actually sea-going boats? Mm. And it's only when you start building the full-scale boat that you can start testing that, that question, really.
So how did you go about building it, Brian?
I approached it as a shipwright would. I've been building traditional wooden boats for about 40 years now. But when I started this job, I realised that I had to really forget thinking like a boat builder and try and think like a Bronze Age man would.
The team used the Bronze Age methods of stitching with yew ropes and waterproofing with moss and beeswax. But with so little of the original to go on, they had to use experience and imagination to fill the gaps. They ended up with a boat fundamentally different from the Dover boat.
The most obvious thing is that our boat is very long and narrow, like a big canoe, and the Dover boat is quite wide. And the only way you can explain that is that the Dover boat was built to carry much more cargo than our boat ever was. Ours was built for speed, really. The Dover boat is quite a bit later than ours, and by that time the cargoes will have increased, so bronze was much more common, and larger cargoes were transported. I think that is the main difference between the two boats.
This is Morgul, which means sea beast in Cornish, which is pretty appropriate, I think, because she's a bit of a beast, isn't she, Robert?
She is.
Is it all right if I get on board? She's pretty robust, isn't she?
She is, absolutely.
How does she handle?
Well, you have to think in the Bronze Age, remember, there were no harbours, there were no jetties. So it doesn't steer like a modern boat, it hasn't got a rudder. But if the crew in the bow and the stern work together well, you can steer around all these boats.
Unlike the Dover boat, Ferriby had a flat bottom and blunt bow. Any waves would bring this boat to a dangerous halt. It was probably a vessel that hugged the coast of Britain, and at 500 years older, it was a stepping stone to the Dover boat, a boat we think was capable of crossing the Channel. To cut through waves, a boat requires a raised front piece, known as the prow. But the team hadn't got a shred of evidence for what this looked like. The prow on the original Dover boat had been ripped out in antiquity. So the team have clamped together the timbers that they bent using steam, and that's left a gap at the end. They've used the shape and angle of this gap as a template for their prow. But it's not as simple as just carving a shape. They've also got to carve a complex joint for it to slot into position.
I think this is going to be a nightmare. This has to be one of the most complicated joints in Bronze Age Europe, I think.
Yeah.
Of course, there were no blueprints or plans that somebody followed. Whoever was in charge of the team that was building this boat had a vision of it in his mind's eye. Perhaps this was a secret magical knowledge that was passed down from father to son, this special knowledge about how to build a boat.
Fingers clear?
Yeah.
Is it going to fit?
It
much, we have to go quite high up with this. Much, much better.
It's feeling good.
This is about as difficult as carpentry gets.
The prow has to take the full force of the waves, so it's most vulnerable to leaks. Days of tiny adjustments lie ahead before it'll be completely watertight.
And it's less than 2 mil, so that'll slide forward nicely.
Big, robust and streamlined, the boat was based at the closest point to the continent. You could stand on the White Cliffs and see France. Clearly it was built to cross the Channel, but why were big boats attempting this treacherous journey? The answer is in the cargoes. We know about them as not every boat made it. At Salcombe Bay, South Devon, the discovery of a Bronze Age shipwreck has revealed what big boats were carrying 3,500 years ago. The artifacts are now in London. I've come here to the British Museum to find out more about the Salcombe shipwreck artifacts. I'm going to meet Ben Roberts, who's the BM specialist in the Bronze Age, to see what he's found out about the hoard and where he thinks it might have come from. So what exactly have we got here, Ben?
We've got a small selection of a huge shipwreck hoard dating back to about 1300, 1200 BC. And so the kind of boat required for all this metalwork here would be something big, something sturdy. It would be a cargo vessel. So I think kind of like the Dover boat, certainly.
But this collection of axes, rapiers, bronze and tin ingots, a small change compared with one object, a 10 kilo ingot of tin. That's more than 20 pound bags of sugar.
Hey, yes, that really is heavy. What do you think the significance is of them having produced an ingot that big?
Well, to make bronze, you need copper and tin. Copper you can get anywhere across Europe. It's really quite a common metal. Tin is really rare, by contrast. Devon and Cornwall, parts of Spain and Portugal, part in Central Europe, and then it starts to get very sparse indeed. So a lot of communities would have wanted as much tin as they can get their hands on, and the demand for tin would be such that you want larger and larger ingots.
The quantity of cargoes like this, the raw materials to make bronze and bronze objects, accelerated at the time of the Dover boat, the Middle Bronze Age.
There was suddenly a great appetite for bronze, and of course, the bronze had to be travelled great distances. So perhaps it's no mistake that when we suddenly see bronze being used all over Western Europe, we first see these complicated sewn plank boats appear.
And the reason the amount of metal suddenly skyrocketed wasn't just down to bigger boats. There was also a sea change in attitudes towards metal.
After about 1500 BC, there is quite a significant change in the way that people used, and I think maybe even thought about, metal objects. suddenly we find that they're being melted down and recast into other objects. And this was when metal becomes a commodity.
Metal didn't totally lose its religious significance. Throughout the whole Bronze Age, objects were still given ritual burial in water. But with much more metal in circulation, there was a booming trade in metal as a commodity in its own right. So was the Dover boat the key to a Bronze Age revolution in trade and travel? We know it was a seafaring craft, the right size and shape to handle ocean waves. But can our modern team match the skills of Bronze Age man and construct a boat that can go to sea? At Dover, the team are feeling the pressure of the ticking clock and looming exhibition. The launch is upon them and they're left with just 24 hours to finish the reconstruction.
It's now 9:30.
Yeah.
And that means we'll be at it till midnight.
It's 10, yeah. Yeah.
They need to join together, stitch and waterproof the entire boat. They know how it was done in the Bronze Age, but their deadline has forced them to take shortcuts. Instead of twine made from yew, they're staining nylon rope. And for the vital waterproofing, they've swapped moss for modern mastic. Phil's not convinced.
You seem to be using it very sparingly, rather than putting a really big, thick, heavy-duty layer on it.
You say that, but I'm using it's almost as thick as a pencil, the bit that I'm putting down, you know.
I've obviously got a lot of faith in this mastic.
With the launch now hours away, work continues long beyond midnight.
Yeah, it really is looking like a boat. Incredible amount of satisfaction putting it together. Incredible amount of work that's gone into it. Just hope it floats. At least there's no icebergs in Dover Harbour.
1, 2, 3. All we've got to do now is put it in the water and see if it floats. this is beautiful, beautiful.
This is the interesting bit.
Midday in Dover, D-Day. It's the reconstruction's first test. The tension is palpable.
This is it, this is the moment of truth. All those years and months and weeks of hard work. No one actually knows whether it will float or not. Saying that there's water going into it. There is some coming in. It doesn't look too dramatic, but there's definitely water going in it. It seems to be coming up through the bottom, through the planking. Yeah, it's really starting to bubble in now.
There's no option but to hoist it out of the water before it sinks completely.
Robin.
Yeah. There's a lot of water coming out. Where's that coming from?
It seemed to be coming up through the middle, but I'm not sure.
How much was in there?
A lot, a lot. It was certainly up to where the stitching is.
Oh, no way.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm sorry about that.
Oh, don't you apologise, mate. I'm sorry for you.
That's all right, I'm sorry for you. It's a pity for everyone, isn't it? It's nice if they'd seen it float.
Yeah, but it will float, won't it?
It will, yeah.
It's a huge disappointment for the team. They head home knowing that when they try again, they need to do things properly. But Phil and I have an alternative plan.
This wasn't supposed to happen, was it?
Maybe we could go to a small bar on the other side of the channel. We've got a boat.
Well, it works for me. Because that way, we'll recreate the experience of Bronze Age people traversing the channel.
Sitting in a bar in Calais, yeah.
The reconstruction's failure underlines just how much we've underestimated the sophistication of Bronze Age people. The assumption that modern methods would do was totally wrong. But our team won't be beaten. They've raised enough money to have one final attempt. It means pulling the whole boat apart and this time putting it back together the Bronze Age way.
I think it's quite easy to think of the Dover boat through modern eyes, and it was quite simple to make, but it wasn't. I mean, first of all, you've got to fell some very large trees. Then you've got to transport them to the site. Then you've got to have the carpenters who will divide the wood up, split it, axe it into shape, and these are very, very experienced boatwrights, we'd call them today. And then those carpenters, in turn, have to be supported by metal workers who would have looked after their axes and their chisels and so on. And then there'd have been a host of other trades. For example, the people who made the caulking, you know, who waterproofed between the different planks. That's a specialist skill. And then you'd have had experts in fibre, twine and cordage. And when you've got your boat built, you've got to have proper seafarers, you know, people who can paddle the boat, people who can navigate. You've got to have a captain, you've got to have someone in charge of it all. It's a very skilled business. You don't just go across the channel and come back on a whim.
3,500 years ago, creating these boats was the equivalent of rocket science. They enabled the transport of cargoes and created wealth and power. We know that during the middle of the Bronze Age, around the time of the Dover boat, there was an explosion of the amount of metal in circulation. And at the dig in Cambridge, they've unearthed absolute proof that this stuff wasn't just traded within Britain, it was coming across from continental Europe.
Superb, Tony, yes, absolutely. I mean,
the sites revealed a treasure trove of metal, including swords, sickles, and spears.
It is intriguing that so much metal has been found around here.
Yes, it is, Tony. I mean, I think there was far more in circulation in the Bronze Age than has been imagined. Bronze was relatively commonplace. You know, it was everywhere. And some of it came from a long way away.
Pretty much wherever there's a hole into this basin, there's been metalwork. The metallurgy analysis on some of the swords from here and from adjacent sites have demonstrated that there are links with the Iberian coastline, northwest France. So, yeah, there's a real sense here of a sort of that connection.
Some of the tin objects we got almost certainly came down the Rhine, across the sea, from the Alps.
It's astonishing that so many thousands of years ago, there was such a complex trade route coming over here to little old Britain.
Well, yes, I think people were in daily contact with the continent. I really do.
It seems we've seriously misjudged not just the skills involved in boat building, but the scale of Bronze Age trade networks. Boats travelled along rivers and coastlines and across the channel, laden with metal. And some astonishing finds are shedding brand new light on the story. Could they be the possessions of a whole new people, a people joined, not separated by the sea? A people who built the Dover boat? After one failed attempt, the reconstruction team are determined to master the skills and success of Dover's Bronze Age boat builders from 3,500 years ago. While the team's woodworking was top-notch, they came a cropper when putting the boat together, believing modern methods were a match for the ancient. So this time, they're using strictly Bronze Age materials.
Ah, Richard! God, really nice to see you again.
And you.
God.
How are you?
Luckily for them, Phil Harding's on hand to literally learn the ropes.
The first thing we've got to do is make our rope. Last time we used a synthetic modern rope. This time we're using the original rope. And the original rope was made out of withies. what we're doing is kind of effectively breaking it into a bundle of long fibres, which can then slide over each other. You see, if once it's twisted up really nicely and the fibres separate, then we could, that makes turns the stick into a rope.
Okay.
I'll show you how it's done. Okay, first thing, you stand on it with your foot like that.
Like that,
on
yeah.
The fat end, okay. And then so you sort of just...
And it, what is it, turning like that?
Yeah, you're using this end as a crank. We want it like a crankshaft, and you're going round and round, and this is actually acting as a handle.
Well, this should
to wind it up.
Why do you make it look so easy? You said you were an expert.
You see that?
No.
Can you see the twist coming in there now?
Yes, but can you see any twists in here? No. This is not as easy as it looks. I swear to God, it is not twisting.
We've got 200 of them to do, so we'll be...
And when's the boat got to go in the water? Oh!
Hey! Well, that one's a goner. It's all right, we've got a few spares. That's what we got to avoid.
Phil's ropey effort highlights yet again the complex skills required to make this craft. But just who was behind the Dover boat? We think the clues are in the cargoes being carried at the time. Hordes of metal goods and raw materials have been recovered by divers from Bronze Age shipwrecks. But one ship was carrying something much rarer, gold. It stunned experts at the British Museum.
These are gold twisted wire bracelets. Only one has been found in Britain before, in North Wales, and two from Northern France. And so they're very much a cross-channel ornament.
They are so fine and so lovely. You have to believe that the people who made this must have worked out some kind of magnification to be able to produce something this fine.
When we had it analysed, the wires are actually less than a millimetre thick, and each of them are individually twisted. There's eight strands there, and then at the very end, it's been soldered using a slightly different composition of gold to create a beautiful end. And they were found wrapped up. So we don't think that they fell off someone's wrist who was actually in the boat at the time. They may have been tended as a gift, but I think it says something pretty special because these gold bracelets are made to such a level of sophistication and are so rare relative to everything else that there had to have been some leaders who were able to control or possess these objects.
This extraordinary gold points to there being a distinct and powerful elite connected by the sea. There's further evidence of that in other stunning artifacts unique to the British and French coasts.
At the centre of it all were some quite specialised coastal communities. Now, these people, they were traders. They would have been boat builders, boat maintainers. They would have built and maintained ships like the Dover boat. And I also think they would probably have been quite skilled linguists. They would have spoken local dialects and, of course, the languages and the dialects on the other side of the channel. So basically, these coastal communities would have controlled trade across the North Sea and across the channel.
But in Britain, these coastal communities have proved elusive. We've only ever found small, isolated farmsteads by the sea that would have housed just a handful of people. Across the channel, though, in Etap, experts found something far more substantial, a coastal settlement for 100 people.
Here we had a settlement that perhaps was big enough to think about building a boat like Dover, and it had English-style houses in it. They were burying their dead in the same way. They were using the same metalwork, the same pottery. All the archaeological evidence points to there being very strong social links between people on either side of the channel. And I think we can think of these people as a single people, the people of La Manche, that were joined by the sea rather than separated by it.
This is an astonishing idea. In the middle of the Bronze Age, the coasts of France and Britain weren't separate entities. The channel was a bridge uniting one elite community, visionary, ambitious, and wealthy. They spoke the same language and lived the same way. These people dominated and controlled trade, and they did it because they produced boats of supreme sophistication. Boats which weren't just practical, but beautiful, made with attention to detail and pride. Boats like this one. Back at Boat Building HQ, our modern team are getting to grips with Bronze Age waterproofing, moss mixed with animal fat.
It is so much thorough than using that mastic. To me, the old system, the old technology, is much more preferable than the modern technology.
The last job is to sew the boat together.
Are you pulling?
Eh?
Are you pulling?
Of course I'm pulling. Oh! Are you pushing?
Yeah. Does that come in there? Bit more?
The rope is fed through holes in the planks, looped three times, and pulled taut.
How we doing?
Yeah, we're pretty much here.
That is a blooming tight stitch there, yeah, feel that.
I told you, Robin, we got you've got some craftsmanship here now. This is what it needs, craftsmanship.
Good job. And feel how it just locks itself off.
Yeah.
Come Brilliant.
On. That ain't going anywhere.
After the first gut-wrenching failure, will this boat finally float? The team simply can't afford another attempt. It's sink or swim.
It's off, we're floating!
Woo!
Yes!
Woo!
After months of head-scratching and sheer hard work, this achievement is a huge relief and a fantastic success. And it's just the start. This boat was engineered for bigger things than a calm creek. If this half-scale craft can handle the tempestuous channel waters, the team will finally have cracked the boat-building secrets of their ancestors.
Here we are, the great moment of truth. Yeah, I know you've actually had it on the water, but how do you reckon it's going to perform actually out on the open sea?
We know that it's quite a manoeuvrable boat. And unless it moves too much and we get too much water in through the seams, it should be great fun going out there.
Thousands of man hours and 20 worn out axes. The Dover boat is ready to launch, this time with authentic waterproofing and stitching.
You want to need a bit of ballast?
How's that feel? Stable?
It's actually not bad at all.
The Dover boat was a pioneer, traversing the channel laden with riches. Now, 3,500 years later, a replica takes to the sea once again.
You did say that the bit you were most concerned about
was out there.
It was out there, and it looks like that's the bit we're heading for.
Are you getting concerned about it yet?
No, not yet. Oh, yeah.
I am. To test the boat in the full force of the open sea, they need to make it past the harbour wall. It's a test of nerve and skill.
That feels like a proper boat, doesn't it?
It bloody well does. It really does. Three. We're round.
In its heyday, the boat was twice this size, powering through waves bearing huge cargoes of metal. This boat was a triumph of ingenious, sophisticated engineering. For Bronze Age sailors with no maps and no life jackets, every voyage was life or death. They were driven by dogged determination and total belief in a boat of technological splendour.
Thank you.
What we've got is a beautiful, manoeuvrable boat, you know, that works perfectly in the river, in the sea, and it's just wonderful, absolutely wonderful.
We could have done with one or two lighter people in the boat, possibly.
I did try and throw him out. But
at the time of the Dover boat, society was changing. Traditional life carried on in places, but on the coast, there were new people. Forward-looking, ambitious, highly skilled, who created the foundations of a new world, a world where, like ours, money and power drove technological change. It was also the beginning of what's arguably Britain's most important tradition, because boats and seafaring prowess made Britain what it is today. It's just that it all happened much earlier than we previously thought. About 4,000 years ago.
Next Sunday from 8 o'clock, a 4,000-year-old tablet that sheds new light on the iconic biblical tale of Noah's Ark, secret history. Next tonight, a relentless personality who overcame hardship to become America's most adored performer, the amazing dramatized life story of Harry Houdini.